Alors aujourd'hui, nous aurons le plaisir d'attendre Maria Hidiroglu, archéologue de terrain très prolifique. Pendant longtemps, elle a mené des fouilles à Karystos, au sud de l'île de Bé, où elle est par ailleurs la conservatrice du musée local. C'est un petit musée, mais doté d'une très belle collection d'inscriptions, de figurines et de sculptures, de statues de l'époque classique, hellénistique et romaine. Mais Maria, elle n'est pas seulement la conservatrice du musée de Karystos, elle est aussi conservatrice des vases au musée archéologique d'Athènes. Elle est aussi responsable des archives photographiques du musée, qui remontent en 1866, date de la fondation du musée. Et aujourd'hui, elle va nous tracer l'histoire de ce musée à travers ces photos. Je sais que tu as préparé une très belle présentation et on te remercie. Et je pense que, Cécile, que c'est notre première séance consacrée à un fond photographique. Hein? Donc,
Oui. Je suis très
voilà.
heureux.
Merci beaucoup, Maria. Et je te passe la parole. Tu vas parler en anglais, mais tu comprends très bien le français. Donc, s'il y a des questions, on peut les poser en français et tu répondras en français ou en anglais, comme tu veux. Donc, encore merci.
Merci beaucoup, Nicolina. Je vous remercie profondément pour l'invitation à participer en ligne au séminaire Vase grec, images, corpus, collection. Mon étude se concentre sur l'histoire du Musée national d'Athènes et les archives photographiques et documentaires du musée. Ces archives illustrent sculptures, vases et objets en bronze du musée, sites archéologiques, monuments antiques et fouilles menées par le service archéologique en Grèce à la fin du 19e et au début du 20e siècle. Cette étude présente une sélection de ces archives avec un bref commentaire sur les objets antiques ainsi que certaines phases dans l'histoire du Musée national d'Athènes. The National Archaeological Museum was founded in Athens in 1866 and it is known through a number of its exhibits, such as the so-called Agamemnon gold mask from Mycenae, the bronze statue of Zeus or Poseidon from the sea area of Artemision at Euboea, a number of Kuri marble statues, the Dipylon amphora, the mechanism from the Antikythera shipwreck, as well as many other ancient objects, including noteworthy collections of Greek vases, terracotta statuettes, bronze artifacts, glass vessels, and jewelry. The history of the National Museum is interesting in manifold ways, as you all know, since apart from the art historical and archaeological wealth of information and cultural dynamics of its collections, the museum fortunes, as well as those of the Greek cultural landscape, can be seen to incorporate aspects of or follow up on changes in modern political and military history. This paper aims to briefly present moments from the history of the National Archaeological Museum in Athens, by tracing the context, provenance, and excavation data, when these are available, of a number of artifacts from its collections. Photographs from the museum archive, early reports, documentation, and other sources will help us trace artifact data and context, as well as gain insights into the early archaeological research in Greece. We will look into the history of the National Museum in its formation period, as well as during the Second World War. We will also glance at some of the best known National Museum collections, together with examples of artifacts, mainly vases, of course, with well-documented provenance, archival inventory or official data, as well as related historical information. The modern Greek state was created in 1828 to 1833 as a result of the war for Greek independence and the European diplomatic consensus and Philhellenic movements of this period. The first National Museum of Greece was founded in March 1829 on the island of Aegina, temporary capital of Greece at that time. The assassination of Ioannis Kapodistrias, first governor of Greece, curtailed all plans for the establishment both of the Greek capital and its first museum on the island. In 1834 and 1835, a number of antiquities, especially sculptures and inscriptions, found in Athens and Attica were kept in temporary storage facilities in the temple of Hephaestus, the area is nowadays known as Theseion, which by 1836 had become actually full. Hadrian's library in Athens was also used as a storage area for ancient sculptures. From Hadrian's library, we see one photographic document from the archive showing the quatrefoil building. From another archive is this photograph of the Hephaestion with the antiquities stored in it. In Otto, in King Otto's period, the Greek Archaeological Service was founded by the royal decree titled On Church and Public Education Matters of the Greek Territory, issued on 3 to 15 April 1833. The decree was based on a former plan by the governor Ioannis Kapodistrias. As of May 1833, Adolf Weisenburg, or Weisenborn, was appointed as the first general ephor of antiquities in Greece. A little later, the archaeologists Ludwig Ross, Kyriakos Pitakis, and Ioannis Kokonis were appointed directors or sub-ephors. The Archaeological Society in Athens was founded in 1837, and its purpose was to contribute to the work of the Archaeological Service by helping towards the research, salvaging, and preservation of antiquities. In King Otto's period, plans for a new museum in Athens, as well as the creation of the first Greek law regarding the protection of antiquities, were set in progress. The main building of the National Archaeological Museum in Athens was founded on 3rd October 1866, based on the architectural plans of Ernst Moritz Theodor Ziller and Ludwig Lanke. The building was, however, completed in 1889, thanks to generous donations by Greek cosmopolitan merchants. In 1891, the museum was greatly enriched, as all the various antiquities, including vases and terracotta statuettes that constituted the museum collection of the Archaeological Society, were transferred to it. The exhibition of all the works of art was effected thanks to the plans and efforts of the archaeologists Panayotis Kavadias, Christos Tsundas, Panayotis Kastriotis, and Valerios Tais. Around 1925, the display of all types of antiquities in the museum had become so crowded that some of its galleries looked like storerooms. A generous and long-term financial plan issued by the Greek government of the period made possible the construction of an extension of the museum built in its eastern end, a project that was completed in 1939, to which we will refer again as we move towards the end of this presentation to the Second World War. In the same period, from late 19th to the first quarter of the 20th century, intense archaeological investigation was undertaken at the most important archaeological sites in Athens and Attica. In 1885, Georg Kaverau and Panayotis Kavadias attempted the first major excavation on the Athenian Acropolis, while beginning in 1895, some of the first restoration works were accomplished there, led by the political engineer Nikolaos Valanos. In 1885, the Archaeological Service began to publish news concerning archaeological topics in the Government Gazette. As of early 1888, the Archaeological Bulletin, Archaeologicon Deltion, was published separately. The first international archaeological conference was held in Athens in the early 20th century with a host of participating scholars from all over the world. The museum, the National Museum Photographic Archive, one of the oldest of the Greek Archaeological Service, and as of recently in process of updating and digitization, houses analog, digitized and digital photographic materials. Among the former are glass plate negatives other types of negatives, slides and prints, the earliest of which date in the late 19th century. The total number of analog photographic materials housed in the archive, such as 35 millimeter films and prints of standard sizes, 13 by 18 and 18 by 24 centimeters, amounts to around 250,000 specimens. Many glass plates and other early negatives of the archive illustrate sculptures and vases acquired by the National Museum in its early period, as well as landscapes, views of early excavations, sites and monuments of the ancient Greek world. An archive of digital and digitized photographs has been developed and enriched in the museum since 2010. During the same period, students of archaeology and other faculties have worked and studied in the archive as part of their internship projects. Recently, a new project has been initiated for conservation, documentation, extensive digitization, and open source development of the museum archive, including both analog digitized and new digital photographic specimens. Through selected digitized photographic plates and postcards from the early years of archaeological photography in Greece, we may tour, metaphorically, some of the earliest excavations in Athens and other Greek regions. A large number of sculptures, vases, and other artifacts of the National Museum come from these early excavations. From among the postcard prints, an example is offered by one print showing a view of Athens and today's parliament taken after 1900. The work of converting Otto's palace into a parliament for the Greek state began in 1930 under the architect Andreas Kriezis. Other examples are glass plates and prints that preserve views of the Roman Agora with Athena Gate, the Tower of Winds, Eleusis, snapshots from the research undertaken by the archaeologist Valerios Stais in the sea area of the island of Antikythera, other sites and regions, as well as a large number of early photographs of museum objects. The excavation of vases of the National Archaeological Museum houses 2,430 specimens of ancient Greek pottery, ranging in date from the sub-Mycenaean period to Hellenistic times. The vases and related clay artifacts, such as, for example, terracotta figurines, are presented in chronological order, classified per painters and workshops, so as to present an educational panoramic view of the development of the art of ancient Greek pottery. In the same exhibition area, there is one gallery with finds from ancient Greek sanctuaries, as you all know, such as the one of Apollo at Thermon in Aetolia, the Iraea at Argos and Perachora, the sanctuary of Poseidon and Athena at Sunion, and the one of Artemis Orthia at Sparta. Thematic showcases with vases and other clay objects with representations from the world of Athenian women, children, and athletics can be seen at the end of the chronological exhibition showcases. There are also other large groups of pottery exhibited in the National Museum, such as the large group of shirts from the Athenian Acropolis, the vases in the Stathatos, and the Vlastos Serpieri collections. In total, more than 36,000 vases, terracotta figurines, lamps, jewelry items, and artifacts made of glass, metal, bone, and other materials are nowadays housed, that is, exhibited and stored in the collections of vases, metal and minor arts artifacts of the National Museum. An example of the early acquisitions of this collection is offered by the well-known late geometric inscribed in Ochoi, found in 1871 at Vipilon in the Keramaikos area. The vase dates from around, we see on the left-hand slide, of course, of the left-hand corner of the slide, the date, the vase dates from around 740 BC and was, as stated by its inscription, the prize for best dancer in some festivity. This graffito, scratched in retrograde on the vase surface, is one of the oldest surviving inscriptions in Greek alphabet, made some brigades after the period of adoption of the Phoenician alphabet by the Greeks and the introduction of vowel sounds in it. Unfortunately, the only photographic material of this important vase are only early photos of the vase itself. The same applies to the two late geometric amphorae, one in the gallery of vases and one in that of the early sculptures that were found in the late 19th century excavations at Dipylon, which are emblematic vases of the National Museum. A number of groups of glass plates record views of the archaeological site of Eloises. The plates must date to the late 19th to early 20th century, the period of the first large-scale excavations at the site. Initial excavation at Eloises began before Greece's liberation from the Ottoman rule. The site was turned into an army camp during the Greek War of Independence. And it was from Eloises that George Karaiskakis, the Greek fighter, marched against the Ottoman army leader Kutakis, who was besieging Athens. During the first years of the new Greek state, excavations at Eloises were carried out by the archaeologists Dimitrios Filios and Andreas Kias. In 1882, the Archaeological Society initiated excavations there, which continued under Konstantinos Kourounotis, beginning in 1917, and were carried on after his death in 1945 by his colleagues, including George Milonas, Ioannis Tepsiadis, and the architect John Travlos. The Sanctuary of Eloises, with its attested mystery rites, was one of the most important ancient cult centers in Greece. Demeter and Kori were worshipped in the sanctuary. The cult began in the Mycenaean age and continued until the late 4th century AD. In the early 6th century BC, the sanctuary was annexed to Athens and the Eleusinian mysteries were incorporated into the religious life of the Athenians. During the rule of Pisistratus, the sanctuary and the city were reinforced by a wall that included towers. Following its destruction in the Persian Wars, the sanctuary was rebuilt. The Great Telesterion, Initiation Hall, and the Stoa of Philo were built a century later. During Roman times, the Great Popilea, not shown in the archival drawing here, the triumphal arches, the fountain, temples, and altars were constructed. The Attic red figure pinax or clay tablet of Ninion, dated around 370 BC, comes from Eloises. It was found in fragments in 1895 in the south court of the sanctuary, near the foundations of the incomplete southern stoa of the Telesterion, and later foundations of a pedestal. The pinax, the plaque, depicts Iacchus, a minor deity of Eloises, leading a procession of initiates into the mysteries. Demeter and Kori receive the initiates. Above the main scene are multiple representations of Selene, the moon. The tablet is the only known, apparently, the only known original representation of the initiation rites for the mysteries. An example of a well-documented find exhibited in the museum is offered by a rich geometric cyst grave excavated in Eloises in September 1895 by the archaeologist Andreas Kias. The original excavation report and publication are quite thorough and have led to a good reconstruction of the find and its context, although sadly drawings are missing, the detailed drawings. Due to a faience statuette, we see on the top right-hand corner, of an Egyptian deity found among the funerary goods, the excavator named the tomb as the one of Isis. And this metaphorical association has remained popular in the bibliography. The tomb contained the skeletal remains of a young female person, jewels such as gold earrings, 67 clay vases, such as three small amphorae, 20 jugs, 14 pyxides, 3 small bowls, a calathos, small bowls and calathos, and other. Also 14 clay balls, perhaps toys, a pair of clay shoe models, and a terracotta horse figurine, all dated around 800 to 760 BC. A number of early black figure finds, most of them exhibited in one of the galleries of vases in the National Archaeological Museum, come from the region of modern Vari in Attica. In ancient times, Athens was the main city of the region of Attica, where several ancient settlements or demes, such as the deme Dimos of Anagyrus in the south, are attested through literary sources and inscriptions. Finds from this cemetery at Vari had first become known in the spring of 1935, when information regarding a large number of vase fragments and other ancient objects that had come to light through illicit digging led the British archaeologist Humphrey Payne and the erudite Greek collector Michael Vlastos to salvage the antiquities revealed there. Thanks to their efforts and organized work, the finds came to the National Archaeological Museum in Athens. The total find consists of a number of large early black figure vases decorated with mythological scenes, animals, monsters, and floral motifs. These vases were reconstructed from fragments. They illustrate aspects of the pioneering early Attic black figure pottery production and its connection to Corinthian ceramic workshops during the archaic period. An example of the fragmented finds is offered by the Attic black figure scyphoid crater we see on the slide of the late 7th century BC, with a scene of Heracles shown as archer liberating bound Prometheus. The modern Greek painter Alexandros Kontopoulos, Alekos or Alexandros, made a frieze drawing of this scene, as well as of the scene of women's procession on the vase stand for the publication of this material by the archaeologist Semni Papaspiridi Karouzou. These archival drawings are exhibited in one of the museum galleries. Later systematic excavation and further research in the cemetery at Vari, such as by the archaeologist Vasilios Kalipolitis, who served as director of the National Museum and general effort of antiquities, revealed more ceramic, terracotta, and other finds. One of the later finds from the cemetery of Anagyrus is a clay game board model, nowadays exhibited in the Museum Gallery of Terracotta Figurines. The clay game board model was found together with a clay cubic die. Both objects were revealed placed as offerings in a cremation burial of the cemetery. The game board bears 4 terracotta figurines of female mourners, one placed on each of the game board corners. 5 impressed lines are preserved on the game board surface or abacus, which indicate that the game board can be interpreted as one of the game pentagramme or 5 lines that is attested by the sources. Oval to circular depressions stand on either side of each of the game lines, representing positions of gaming stones. The model from Vari and its die are dated in the 7th century BC, probably around 675 to 650 BC. A similar clay game board model has been found in the Athenian Keramaikos, and there are only a few other parallels. The models from Vari and the Keramaikos that come from graves are funerary goods. As their fine context suggests, they are probably to be interpreted as connected to ancient religious ideas regarding perhaps the enjoyment of life's pleasures in the underworld, or as symbolic funerary goods or metaphors for life's journey as a mortal game. Board and other games were a favorite pastime of the Greeks, Egyptians, and other Mediterranean people, and they seem to have acquired symbolisms for matters both of everyday life and death. We move to a large subject. The glass plates of the National Museum Archive that record moments from the excavation the archaeologist Nikolaos Kyparisis conducted at the site of the Royal Stables in Athens in 1924 to 1925 are also interesting. The royal stables of King Otto were located in the square enclosed by the streets Stadiou, Amerikis, Panepistimiou, and Voukourestiou. Efforts to free up and develop the site had begun early in the second decade of the 20th century. In the end, the Army Pension Fund building was constructed there based on designs by the architects Vasilis Kassandras and Leonidas Bonis. In 2007, the building was converted to a center known today as Attica Mall, which is hosting shops, restaurants, theaters, and other commercial establishments. A large cemetery dating from classical to Roman times was excavated at the site of the royal stables. Important sculptures and vases in the National Archaeological Museum come from graves in this cemetery. The marble lithos of Mirini and the inscribed funerary stele of Calippe of the late 5th century BC come from this excavation. On the relief lithos dated around 420 BC, Hermes Psychopompos is depicted in the center holding the deceased Mirini's hand, leading her on to the underworld. Three other figures at left, probably relatives, are watching the scene. The marble stele of Calippe, with inventory number 3610, bears a relief scene of a seated female figure holding a little girl on her knees. The child has her hands extended to receive a gift, probably a small bird, from the woman. Of the vases found in the cemetery's tombs, the best known is the red figure, Arivalos, dated to 485 to 480 BC. According to the inscription, Doris Epison, Doris painted this on the shoulder. The vase was painted by the renowned vase painter Thuris. The Arivalos features a scene of a youth being chased by two flying erotes. Behind the youth inscription, this lithos belongs to Asopodoros, Asopodoro Ilikithos, indicates the owner of the vase. The black figure Lutroforos Hydria of the early 5th century BC with scenes of mourning and the prothesis of the deceased one is also from this cemetery. Also from the same cemetery is the Attic red figure Lutroforos in the manner of the washing painter we see on the right-hand side of the slide. It bears a wedding preparation scene in the women's quarters and it is dated in 415 to 410 BC. The bride in a pleated chiton and imation, wearing earrings and crowned with a diadem, is seated on a klismos chair between women with a casket in her lap. On the casket, which contains her jewelry or other personal items, sits a winged eros holding a wreath. Another wreath and a formiscus, a bag, hang above. The scene contains the basic elements of the wedding and life of an urban wife whose main concerns were the continuation of the family line and looking after the house. Lutrofori are believed to have been ritual wedding vessels, as you know, used to fetch water for the bridal bath from the Kaliroi or Eneakronos spring and fountain house in Athens. Lutrofori were also set up over the tombs of those who died before marriage. The grave of Hephaestus from Chios with its funerary stele and ash container was recorded in a drawing by Alekos Kontopoulos. It is testified that he was not present and during the excavation, and the drawing was based on a description given to the painter by the excavator. The ash container is the mid 5th century BC Attic red figure Peliki of the Polygnotos group that is decorated with a scene of a warrior or Achilles receiving his arms, a helmet, and a shield from a female figure, and his spear and sword from another one. The collection of vases and terracotta figurines of the National Archaeological Museum house a number of finds from the early excavations in Eretria and other regions of the island of Euboea. The funerary piece of Sanforet late geometric orientalizing an early black figure once excavated by the archaeologist Konstantinos Kourouniotis at one of the large ancient cemeteries of Eretria offer an example. We see the Pythos amphorae here with photographic, early photographic material. Unfortunately, not one photograph of the archive, not one glass plate shows the excavation of such the Pythos amphora in Eretria. The early excavation reports, albeit not detailed ones, are quite informative as to the use of the vases as graves for young children. The Euboean black figure Pythos amphorae from Eretria, together with a group of black figure Lichithoi and other vases housed in Chalkis and Eretria museums, represent a compendium of the so-called Euboean black figure pottery style. A number of photographic glass plates of the National Museum Archive depict views from the excavations Konstantinos Kourouniotis conducted in Eretria. One instance is the plate that preserves a photograph of the building remains of the Temple of Apollo Daphniphoros at Eretria, a site that was initially excavated in the period from 1899 to 1911. In this important polis sanctuary, worship and rituals are attested to have begun in the second half of the 8th century BC and continued to Hellenistic times. The first geometric building was succeeded by a construction of the 7th century BC and that one by a Doric temple built in the late 6th century BC. We will now present a case study of finds from Euboea housed in the National Archaeological Museum in Athens with their preserved very brief excavation data. In the late 19th to early 20th century, the archaeologists Christos Tsundas, Konstantinos Kourouniotis, George Papavasiliou, and their colleagues of the American School of Classical Studies in Athens excavated sites in Eretria, Chalkis, and Charistos. Excavation research in Euboea was then deemed urgent because of the extensive looting that had been noted in the third quarter of the 19th century. A large number of ancient graves were excavated in all the main Euboean cities. Eretria and Chalkis proved to have had rich cemeteries with groups of graves that covered the period from the 8th century BC to late Roman times. Preserved reports of these excavations are rather short when compared to current methodology and process. Due to the lack of museums in Euboea, and as the standard procedure of the period would have it, most of the finds were transferred to the National Archaeological Museum in Athens, where they formed part of its early collections. Since the mid-20th century, systematic salvage and research work has been undertaken in Eretria and other parts of Euboea, both by the service and a number of archaeological schools, especially and mainly by the Swiss Archaeological School in Eretria. A large number of Lichithoi of well-known Attic workshops were found in the classical cemeteries in Euboea, as in many other Greek sites. In 1900, one of the early excavators, George Papavasiliou, on the left-hand slide, of course, of the slide, noted the large number of Lichithoi found in graves of the 6th and 5th centuries BC he excavated in Euboea. Papavasiliou was a high school director and collaborator of the Archaeological Society in Athens during the late 19th century. With funds from the Archaeological Society, he excavated the largest known number of graves in Chalkis, Aliveri, modern town, and Charistos. In a letter to the Society, Papavasiliou reports that he had found fragments of Lichithoi damaged by pyre and burned and other Lichithoi of the archaic period in Chalkis that were decorated with scenes of excellent craftsmanship. The same observation was made for graves excavated in Eretria throughout modern times. Attic Lichithoi of the Phanilis group of the years around the end of the 6th century BC were found in Euboea. An example is the Lichithos shown on the slide of the years about 530 to 520 BC, found in a grave, of course, in Eretria. It is decorated with a scene of warrior arming and departure. The warrior stands between pairs of onlookers, women and draped youths with spears. The typical line motif on the neck emphasizes its form. palmettes and lotus buds decorate the shoulders. Arming, warrior, departure, and Dionysian scenes, especially representations of Dionysus between eyes, are some of the favorite subjects of this group. The Attic ceramic imports to Euboea increased in the 5th century BC. Two well-known Attic white ground black figure Lichithoi in the National Archaeological Museum come from the same grave excavated in Eretria around 1892. They are works of the Atina painter and they are dated in the first quarter of the 5th century BC. One Lichithos bears a representation of Heracles holding the sky with Atlas holding the apples of Hesperides in his hands nearby, and the other one the scene of Odysseus's arrival at Tyrkis Island and the beginning of the transformation of his comrades to boars. The story of Kirki, her magic powers, and Odysseus's infatuation with her is mentioned in the Odyssey. Heracles is a favorite subject of the Athena painter and his workshop, as we can see from Lichithoi and Trefoil Mouth Inokoe by his hand and his group in Boston, Tübingen, and Kurasiki. Also popular are his studied representations of goddesses, such as Athena on his name vase, here on the left, also from Eretria, dated around 490 to 480 BC, and other female figures. The Athena painter is considered to have begun his career later than the Theseus painter. All these are well-known Lichithos painter. He must therefore have been active in the second quarter of the 5th century BC. And his products were widely distributed through trade, with a primary example, or the one at Eretria. The Athena and the Theseus painters followed the Edinburgh painter in the use of white ground for the Lichithoi, as well as for the use of new motifs for the shoulder of these vases. A well-published Attic white ground Lichithos, black figure Lichithos of the Edinburgh painter, dated around 500 BC, was found in another grave in Eretria, a scene of young Achilles led by his father to the wise centaur Chiron, who is considered to have taught the hero handling and music, is depicted on it, and it may reflect a local buyer's choice. Black figure Lichithoi of the class of Athens 581 have been found in more than one Euboean cemeteries and cities. A number were found in Eretria and Karistos, while the situation in Chalkis remains rather unknown. A dance group consisting of two menads and two satyrs is depicted on one of the Lichithoi of this class from Eretria, attributed to the painter of Munich 1874. Dionysus, Athena, a seated male figure, and a dancing menad are depicted on a Lichithos of this class from Karistos, from a grave full of Attic black figure vases and terracottas, imported and some locally produced. The class of Athens 581 developed out of the work of the Marathon painter, who decorated a number of the Lichithoi found in the Marathon tumulus, and they are therefore easily dated around 490 BC. Their subjects are mythological, often Dionysian, occasionally generic ones, and the background is often filled with leafy twigs, as examples in Athens, Palermo, and Taranto show. A scene of Dionysian procession of satyrs riding Ithyphallic mules is found on one of the Lichithoi of the class of Athens 581. The vase was found in 1889 in Eretria. Vases of this class are widely distributed in many Greek regions, as you know. Another example of a black figure, an Attic black figure Lichithos of a popular group found in Eretria, is the one attributed to the Leagros group. It is decorated with a scene that appears in several late archaic Lichithoi of Heracles squatting on a rock while Helios, the sun, in a two-horse chariot, flies over the sea. In myth, Heracles used the gold cup of Helios to travel to the island of Erythia, which is supposed to be located beyond the Heraclean stele at modern Gibraltar, so as to confront the three-bodied Geryones. Some iconographic subjects of the Attic Lykithoi found in Euboea can perhaps be considered as more popular than others for all imports, such as scenes from myths of Heracles, of Odysseus, as well as scenes of ritual context. Some Lykithoi from the Euboean cemeteries are decorated with everyday or religious scenes. An example is the late archaic Attic black figure Lykithos from Eretria, attributed to the cactus painter on the left, with the depiction of a young man pursued by snakes, a scene probably with reference to ritual and also connected by some in bibliography to the myth of Orestes. There are also a number of Attic black figure and white crown Lykithoi of the Beldam and Hemon workshops found in Eretria, such as one white ground and semi-outline of the former, dated around 470 BC on the right, showing the visit to the grave. A final chapter in this presentation concerns archival data on the subject of the protection of antiquities during the Second World War. One of the most important issues countries and archaeological services ever faced in their cultural history. It is with great sadness that we hear on the news of wars nowadays, a subject always, unfortunately, always there. Similar protection measures are documented during the Second World War for the Acropolis Museum, the Numismatic, Byzantine, and the Keramikos Museums, for the museum and site in Delphi, as well as for other Greek and European museums or collections, such as the Louvre in Paris and Palermo in Italy. A short time before late October 1940, a two-storied annex with two inner courts had been added to the eastern side of the National Museum. This annex constituted the second expansion of the main building. It was based on the plans of the architect George Domikos, and its construction had lasted from 1932 to 1939. In the National Museum, the main part of the project to protect and bury the museum antiquities was initiated exactly after the completion of this construction in late October 1940, immediately upon the official involvement of Greece in the Second World War. Official documents issued by Greek public services in the period before and during the Second World War eliminate aspects of museum works and assignments during these turbulent times. We even see a drawing of the pits to be opened in various museums, including the national one. As an example, I mentioned a document of the National Museum dated 29th May 1940 and signed by Semini Papaspiridi Karouzou, archaeologist and ephor of antiquities in the museum at that time. Semini Papaspiridi was married to the archaeologist Christos Karouzos, who became the director of the National Museum in 1941. Their work, research, and achievements sealed the history of the National Museum and that of the Greek Archaeological Service of the mid to the second half of the 20th century. So this is a document on the subject of measures for the protection of antiquities in case of air raids. Because this burial project was to protect the antiquities from being broken due to building collapse. The work of packing and burying almost all of the antiquities of the National Museum began and was completed during the 6 months from late October 1940 to April 1941. As Karouzou, Semni noted, archaeologists, conservators, workmen, other employees and volunteers worked together day and night for this purpose. Catalogs were kept and artifacts were inventoried before packing and burial. Among the volunteers are mentioned members of the foreign archaeological schools of Athens, such as Otto Walker of the Austrian Institute, Alan Joy Bayard-Weiss of the British School, and Rodney Stewart Young of the American School of Classical Studies. As a result, during the war, the antiquities of the National Museum remained buried in the soil below the museum, or in case of pottery, in wooden boxes buried in sand-filled basement rooms. The large marble statues were placed below the floors of their exhibition galleries. The cement-built basement of the newly constructed annex served as the burying ground of boxes of pottery and ceramic artifacts that were covered with piles of sand up to a height of 3 to 4 meters. The official documentation also shows that during the war, gold and silver jewelry items of the museum, as well as many artifacts of the Mycenaean collection, were kept in the treasury of the Bank of Greece. All these measures serve to protect antiquities from bombing trepidations, blasts, and building collapse. Despite these protections, these protective measures, atrocities, illicit excavations, and theft of antiquities were noted in many regions, not in the National Museum, during the period of Nazi occupation of Greece, as well as in a number of other countries. Let's move on to the photographic material. The snapshots from the museum photographic archive illustrate in an almost cinematic order the digging of pits in the floors of the museum rooms, the packing and burying of the marble and bronze statues, the boxing of clay vases. We see one of the Dipylon amphorae, the one with the inventory number 803, being boxed. And also we have on the photographic material, the empty museum galleries. These photographs are taken in the 6 months we talked about, are preserved in the museum, in the archive, both as negatives and prints. And on one of their envelopes, there is preserved a stamp of the photographic atelier of Emile Seraf. In March 1946, that is almost a year, 1.5 years after the liberation of Athens from the Nazi occupation, which was on the 12th October 1944, the employees of the National Museum undertook the large work of excavating the burial pits, as well as that of the restoration of the buried antiquities. The first priority was to restore at least a main part of the museum exhibition. The whole project was again led by the museum director Christos Karouzos and Semni Papaspiridi Karouzou. The first small post-war exhibition was opened in 1947. Reconstruction and restoration works in the museum continued, however, throughout the 1950s. We conclude. We have overviewed some phases in the history of the National Archaeological Museum and the creation of its main collection of vases, with instances, of course. We have also traced data on the fine circumstances or context of a selected number of the museum groups of vases, such as a case from Eloises, the groups from Vari and the Royal Stables, and the grave finds from Eretria. We tried to investigate each case with the help of available archival data, including early reports, inventories, documents, letter communication, paintings, and analog photographic material. Not all these data can recover lost information, of course. A large number of artifacts housed in the collections of the National Museum in Athens were found in excavations undertaken by the Archaeological Service or the Archaeological Society in late 19th to early 20th century, a period when not many regional museums existed in Greece. Salvaging the antiquities from destruction or theft in uncontrolled building development projects in Greece has been one of the main creation purposes, both of the Archaeological Service and the early National Museum, the museum in its early days. Nowadays, the museum participates in or creates new thematic exhibitions, fosters education programs, preserves and promotes Greek and international cultural projects. One of the various work purposes of this modern extrovert museum is to welcome researchers from all over the world to study artifacts from its collections. Research on museum artifacts and the history of the National Museum itself can be seen to benefit from a thorough look in various archives. And there are more archives, as for example, the one of the Archaeological Society, including the Museum Photographic Archive. The material housed in this archive preserves photographic data from the history of the archaeological service, from the history of the museum, the find sites of its antiquities, as well as documents a variety of archaeological activities and early excavations. Through the archive's glass photographic plates, we come to know views of pre-modern Athens, its archaeological sites and monuments. Investigation, salvaging, and preservation of these sites and monuments formed the life work of the early archaeology in Greece, of the pioneers of the archaeological service, as well as of early academics of some of the best known foreign institutes in Greece. A noteworthy file case is the archive of black and white photos and negatives that document the burial of the museum's antiquities during the Second World War. This material represents an assemblage of data that illustrates, that presents snapshots of a memorable period in the history of the museum and its people. Some of the digitized photographic material that we saw was also presented in a number of photographic exhibitions organized by the National Museum in its premises and in other venues. And my heartfelt thanks are due to all colleagues and friends who helped with these projects. Thank you very much for your attention.
Merci, merci beaucoup Maria pour ce bel exposé qui, comme Nicolina le disait, effectivement, on s'est souvent intéressé dans ces conférences plutôt sur les collections, mais là on était très heureux de pouvoir vous entendre sur les archives du musée, puisqu'on sait évidemment l'importance de ces fonds dont on s'intéresse de plus en plus, les fonds d'archives, et puis les images, notamment les photographies, on l'a vu, qui depuis le 19e siècle nous retracent non seulement l'histoire du musée, l'histoire des œuvres, mais aussi et surtout comme dans un musée comme le Musée national d'Athènes, une histoire de l'archéologie, une histoire du patrimoine, et qui est évidemment toujours liée à l'histoire politique du pays, non seulement évidemment dès la création au 19e siècle, et puis vous l'avez rappelé avec cette dernière partie très poignante sur le sort des œuvres pendant la Seconde Guerre mondiale. Et ces sources, évidemment, aujourd'hui, sont aussi très précieuses. Et là aussi, on l'a bien vu avec tous les exemples que vous avez pris pour connaître les provenances archéologiques. Et à Athènes, vous avez beaucoup de vases ou d'objets qui viennent de fouilles qui sont alors pas toujours complètement documentées comme on l'a vu, mais qui au moins ont un certain nombre de données et que parfois on redécouvre aussi en replongeant dans ces archives. Et puis depuis une heure, on a aussi une sorte de panorama de certains des objets les plus importants de vos collections. Donc, c'était vraiment extrêmement intéressant. Alors, vous avez parlé de beaucoup de choses et je pense qu'on va avoir des questions. Moi, j'avais envie de revenir parce que pour commencer sur la dernière partie, sur cette protection des œuvres pendant la Deuxième Guerre mondiale, et notamment sur ces puits créés pour enterrer une partie des œuvres, parce qu'effectivement, on sait que beaucoup de musées en Europe ont pris des mesures pour protéger les objets, les œuvres. Et alors en France, moi je connaissais des exemples où les musées ont plutôt déménagé leur collection, notamment loin de Paris ou loin du nord de la France, mais je n'avais jamais vu ces photos d'antiquités enterrées. Et c'est, c'est spécifique à Athènes ou est-ce que ça s'est fait de manière plus large en Grèce
Oui. C'est, in Athens, it was the largest project of burial. Because the museum was found, was based, was built on perimeter walls. So the interior of the floors, the underside of the floors could be dug. People could dig below the floor rooms because there were no real pedestal supports in the form of pedestals as in modern buildings. So the basements were actually free. In this period today, these basements are the storerooms, are today's storerooms. Yes, after extensive architectural work there. Yes. So Athens, yes, we have a huge burial project of burying the antiquities. And also the same type of project in Delphi, for example. Also some caves were used, the ones of the Acropolis area, other basements. It was, these were huge projects, and I'm sure that every option, every solution possible was followed up on.
Et c'était, j'ai trouvé que c'était cette sorte de d'archéologie à l'envers où on remet en terre les objets.
Oui, évidemment. Oh, terrible.
Oui. Et ça faisait un écho avec les premières images que vous avez montrées avant la création du musée, avec l'utilisation notamment du temple d'Héphaïstos comme entrepôt pour les œuvres. Ça, c'est incroyable aussi, ces photos.
Oui, oui.
Précisément, il était utilisé seulement comme réserve où on pouvait visiter.
On pouvait visiter quelque part, mais seulement
une partie.
Un partie.
Donc il y avait des antiquités qui étaient exposées.
Oui, oui. The visitors could move around the antiquities, and it was a rather crowded place. No good photographic material comes from this. This is one of the very few photographs preserved of this strange Hephaestion phase.
C'est dommage.
Dommage, oui.
Est-ce que les collections de vases continuent, est-ce que la collection de vases continue d'être enrichie aujourd'hui?
Very rarely, when there is purchase, when the museum buys from collectors or antique dealers, but this very rarely happens. It has to be something unique, really unique. I don't know, Berlin painter, I don't know, something really grand. It happens rarely. And till now, this is all state-funded work and projects. So economics matter also, not only the choices, but also the a matter of finance.
Est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions?
Alors moi, j'en ai une autre aussi. On a vu beaucoup de photographies donc, qui sont conservées et vous nous avez montré quelques dessins, quelques croquis et puis alors, des dessins, j'ai noté, de un Kontopoulos, des dessins aquarellés.
Oui.
Oui. Alors, ça qui m'intéresse, parce que ça m'intéresse beaucoup à ces dessins d'objets dans les musées. Et c'était, je me demandais si on pouvait en savoir un peu plus, c'était un dessinateur qui était employé par le musée pour dessiner des œuvres, ou est-ce qu'il a fait beaucoup de choses
Merci. Thank you for your question. My omission. He was an employee of the museum. He had studied in Paris, called the Beaux-Arts, And strangely, we find him working as a permanent employee of the museum. Of course, that didn't stop. That didn't stop people, artists of this magnitude, of this size, to undertake works outside the museum and work for their own or make exhibitions on their own. Mm. But Kodopoulos and Sarafianos, we know through documentary archives that they used to be permanent employees of the museum.
Et ils étaient employés pour dessiner la collection.
Oui. We also, the museum also employs an artist today. So there is this position of artist of the museum.
D'accord.
This is the line that probably began from the Gigueron and continued as an idea for this national museum. It was the idea that this museum, large museums, should employ an artist of their own.
Et où est-ce qu'on peut voir ces dessins?
Kodopoulos designs, we can, the visitor, anyone can see them in the Gallery of Vases. At the end of the gallery, there is a space dedicated to the work of the painters. It's on the tour of the museum. You are welcome. We can tour this gallery together and talk and learn some more.
Et du coup, les photographies qui sont conservées, il y avait aussi des photographes qui étaient employés
oui.
Du coup, par le musée, à la fois des...
Oui. It is very hard to investigate the names of photographers. Very rarely, they are very rarely preserved in notes, in forms of notes, or in early publications. If early archaeologists of those early days thought fit to thank photographers, it's a good thing for us that we can identify these people and pay homage to them, tribute to them. If they are not memorized in this way, if they are not their names are not have not been written down, unfortunately there is a question mark here. Unfortunately, it's an idea that I really don't like, that we have photographic material without names of photographers. Some early photographers are Petritsis and Halkiopoulos. They worked for Kourounioti's. And they participated in the Greek-Turkish war in Turkey, in Asia Minor, in 1921-1922. There were excavations undertaken in the area of modern Izmir, in the area of Ephesus, by the archaeological service in these years when there was this Greek-Turkish war, which ended with the catastrophe, the damage of the fire of Smyrna. So two names are mentioned by Kourounioti's. Halkiopoulos, I don't know the small name, Alpha Halkiopoulos, and Petritsis. I don't know the first name. Mm.
Même, oui, ça c'est un problème un peu, je crois qu'on rencontre partout pour avoir les noms effectivement des photographes et parfois aussi le nom des dessinateurs qui n'est pas toujours, pas toujours conservé. Ouais. Et je me demandais si, comme il y a beaucoup de plaques de verre dans votre collection, est-ce que ça avait aussi un rôle pour l'enseignement, ou est-ce que c'était uniquement la documentation pour le musée, ou est-ce qu'il y avait des liens, est-ce que ce matériel pouvait aussi être utilisé à l'université ou ailleurs?
This project that started in September with funds both from Greece and the European Community, has as a purpose to make an open source of this material open to everyone online, and also to encourage researchers to work in the archive, for the archive, study in the archive. This is now beginning in a systematic way.
D'accord. On ne t'entend pas, Nicole.
Oui, pardon. Le fonds photographique est en ligne?
Very, very, not now, not at this, in this period, very few instances, very few examples are online in the museum web page. But the purpose is to make a separate link with all the photographic material uploaded. This is the final, the final phase of this project. It's long overdue. I realized that, of course, it should have been made ages ago, but it's a good thing because first, in the first phase, we have the conserving of two conservators working for the conservation of the glass plates, and then the scanning or photography, and then the documentation, and then the uploading. So it's a stepped process.
Hmm.
And I realize it's long overdue. It should have been made ages ago.
C'est bien de savoir que dans quelques temps, on pourra découvrir tout ça en ligne.
It should have been ready by, I don't know, by the 90s, I don't know. Early 2000s, I don't know.
Je ne sais pas s'il y a des questions. Annie.
Alors oui, j'active, voilà. Je voulais d'abord remercier notre collègue d'avoir fait revivre l'histoire ancienne de ce magnifique musée et de nous avoir fait revivre aussi tous ces grands noms de l'archéologie grecque qui apparaissaient même avec un visage grâce aux photographies et qui nous les rendaient encore plus proches, je pense. J'aurais une question, si possible, concernant l'histoire plus récente des collections, notamment à propos des fragments et vases de l'Acropole. Mmh. Vous les avez mentionnés, bien entendu, comme partie intégrante du Musée archéologique national, mais j'aurais aimé savoir comment s'est faite la répartition récente entre le musée national et le nouveau musée de l'Acropole. Donc là, on est dans l'histoire non pas ancienne, mais dans l'histoire récente des collections qui bougent parfois. Et j'aurais aimé avoir plus de précisions sur cette répartition et sur le sort des vases de l'Acropole du musée d'Athènes. Acropolis Collection.
Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup. Merci beaucoup, en tout cas.
Je vous remercie. Thank you very much for your question. This is a very interesting subject again. The museum, when the new Acropolis Museum, a magnificent museum, was organized, the National Museum offered as a permanent loan lots of sculptures, vase fragments. Some of the best vase fragments are now in the Acropolis Museum. And recently, more sculptures and fragments were submitted, donated to the new Acropolis Museum. Of course, there are other fragments. I don't know if there is a project of continuation of this donation, or they are considered as to remain in the National Museum. But we have been, the museum has been very generous towards the new Acropolis Museum. Some of the best vase fragments are nowadays exhibited in the new Acropolis Museum, the Evergithis Kilix and others, the white ground cups and other magnificent, some of the best Greek painters.
Yes, we have seen them in the Acropolis Museum collection, but not all of them are
not
there.
All of them, yes.
And it's just alone.
There are thousands. To be honest, there are thousands. Perhaps
a new
museum should be only to the Gräflanglodge collection, so to speak. A whole new museum is required for this. Some are exhibited in the National Museum. Most of these finds are in storage. So there is now a huge project of extending, of making an expansion of this National Museum. I don't know if this expansion will cover the Acropolis shards all exhibited, or they are all to be given as permanent loans to the new Acropolis Museum. These are long-term plans, and I don't have the politics in me to decide for this type of question. You are right, more should be exhibited and more should be accessible to researchers.
Yes, in the National Museum, in the National Museum, why not?
Yes. Let us hope it will expand. There are huge plans of expansion. Let us hope.
Let us hope. The
next generation, perhaps, or some years from now.
We hope with you. We hope with you. And do you have archives concerning the Gräflanglodge publication? Do you have archives in the National Museum?
No, I searched. Oh. I searched really hard for this presentation because I wanted to focus on the Acropolis shards. I like the subject, but I found nothing on the photographic archive to relate to. So I took up the Royal Staples instead.
Yeah, thank you for your answer. Thank you.
From this Gräflanglodge period or before. Nothing from the Caveirão Cavadias period. No. The photograph I've showed you of Caveirão Cavadias excavating in the Acropolis comes from the publication, from the early Caveirão Cavadias publication. We don't have glass plates on this.
Oh, no.
The archives are the what stays in an archive and what goes to another place is such a matter of chance. I mean, in these days, in the old days. Oh. So.
Yes, that's a difficult problem. Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much for your.
I thank you. Je vous remercie.
Irene.
Je voudrais en tout cas remercier beaucoup Maria Kiviroglou pour cette présentation et pour les questions que vous lui avez posées. Et je voudrais la remercier encore plus sous les conditions actuelles que vous connaissez tous. Et dans le sens où les projets et les plans que ces archéologues donc, du Musée national qui se battent aujourd'hui essayent de faire le mieux, essayent de faire des projets et les soutenir sans savoir vraiment si demain ils pourront les réaliser avec les lois qui sont en train de passer, que vous connaissez. Et je souhaite vraiment de mon cœur qu'ils arrivent à les réaliser et ils arrivent à vraiment faire ce qu'ils, toutes bonnes choses qu'ils ont en tête, à commencer par les couleurs du musée jusqu'à faire le mieux possible pour les collections. Parce que tout ne va pas toujours dans le sens qu'ils veulent au niveau politique. Et vous savez bien, vous avez déjà signé donc, les pétitions donc, pour ces nouvelles lois qui visent à changer donc, le mode de fonctionnement de 5 grands musées grecs, parmi lesquels le premier est le musée national. Donc Maria fait partie de ces gens qui se battent avec les projets en cours pour garder les collections, pour les mettre en valeur. Merci beaucoup à Nicolina, merci à Cécile, merci à Alain, merci à tous.
Merci beaucoup. Merci.
Alors, je ne sais pas s'il y a d'autres d'autres questions. On a eu un mot de Claire Ballandier qui remerciait dans le chat, qui remerciait pour la, qui disait Claire. La conférence était très intéressante. Je vais faire un tour.
You're all welcome to the museum anytime you wish to study, to visit, have coffee with me.
Avec grand plaisir, je crois que ça nous a tous donné très envie de revenir à Athènes et de revisiter les collections et de venir voir les archives.
Évidemment.
Mais oui. Je ne sais pas, Nicolina, si tu as... Non, et ben alors s'il n'y a plus de questions, tout était très clair. Ben encore merci beaucoup.
Je vous remercie.
Merci, Marie. Un grand merci.
Un grand merci à toutes et tous.
Merci beaucoup. Merci aux organisatrices.
Oui, merci.
Grand merci aux organisatrices.
Très bien. Et bon courage.
Merci à toi.
Bon courage à Athènes.
Oui.
Bon courage.
Bon courage, oui.
Merci beaucoup. Cécile, notre prochaine séance, tu as l'agenda?
Eh bien, ça sera le 20 mai. Non?
Ah, il n'y a pas... D'accord.
Alors, attends.
Le 20 mai.
Donc, la prochaine séance vase grecque, oui, c'est pour...
C'est Giorgos Kavadias.
Kavadias.
C'est ça, on va continuer avec le Musée national d'Athènes.
Est-ce qu'il est le petit-fils de Panayotis Kavadias? Est-ce qu'ils ont un lien?
I have heard his lecturing on Panayotis Kavadias, and he has denied a straight relationship. But of course, they both come from Kefalonia, Kefalonia, the Ionian island. Of course, from the same region of this island.
Oh.
They share the surname. It's one of the main questions for when we meet Kavadias. But I heard his lecture in Athens some years ago. He presented the Panayotis Kavadias excellently.
Mm-hmm. Très bien. Donc il va nous présenter la très belle collection de Vlastos.
Avec archives. Il y a plusieurs archives magnifiques. Très détaillées archives.
Très bien.
On sera ravis, ça sera très complémentaire avec la présentation d'aujourd'hui.
Normalement en présentiel, mais enfin, on verra bien. Sinon, mais on peut peut-être prévoir un mode hybride, on verra.
On verra.
Oui, si possible, quand même. Ah. Pensez aux voisins.
Il faut écrire à l'INHA. Et dans ces cas-là, Maria, peut-être que tu seras là, toi aussi.
Oui, oui, oui. On va essayer, mais c'est toujours... les règles changent de mois en mois pour l'organisation de tout ça. On va essayer de le maintenir à distance, au moins.
Merci.
Merci à tous. Merci à toutes.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci à tout le monde.
Merci. Au revoir.
Au revoir.